Welcome to you. In this video, we are going to start chapter 2 in Microwave Engineering by D.M. Bazar. And chapter 2 is focused on transmission line theory. In this video, we are going to introduce what is meant by transmission line and what are the different types of transmission lines. In electromagnetic waves, we have two main problems: guided wave problems and radiated wave problems. In guided wave problems, the electromagnetic waves are guided by wave guiding structure. And the definition of wave guiding structure is that one that carries a signal or power from one point to another. We have main three types of wave guiding structures: simple transmission lines, waveguides, and optical fibers. In this chapter, we are going to study transmission lines. In the following chapter, we are going to study waveguides. Effectively, optical fiber is the main topic of optical communication systems. So we may discuss optical fiber in very brief, but our course is basically based on transmission lines and waveguides. Effectively, the common type of transmission lines is based on two conductors. And the very simple configuration of transmission line is the barrel wire transmission line, which constitute as two wires going barrel to each other and separated by dielectric material. But effectively, this configuration can be modified to be as one inner conductor surrounded by an outer conductor in a coaxial cylindrical shape, and this is known as a coaxial cable. So in general, the transmission line has two wires. In low frequency or in DC, we say one is positive and the other is negative, for example. So at least we have two ports or two conductors. So transmission lines has two conductors run parallel to each other, maybe parallel or one inside the other, like in the case of coaxial transmission line. Effectively, these transmission lines are used starting from DC, and theoretically it can be used at any frequency. So can propagate a signal at any frequency in theory. At high frequencies, such a transmission lines becomes lossy. Effectively, we have different mechanisms of losses inside transmission lines. The first mechanism is that the two conductors are not made of perfect conductor. They are made of practical conductor with finite conductivity. So the wire of the transmission lines has a resistance, and because there is current is passing through these wires, there will be dissipated power. In the AC, it would equal half I squared R, where R is the resistance of these wires. Also, the dielectric which separates the two wires may not be ideal dielectric material. It means that it has finite conductivity. So this finite conductivity would introduce barrier resistance between the two wires, or barrier conductance between the two wires. This conductance represents a leakage of the current from one wire to the other, which represents losses in transmission line. Because effectively, the basic concept of the transmission line is to transfer the power from point A to point B. So if there is some leakage in the midway between the point A and the point B, this leakage would correspond to losses. So effectively, we have resistance losses, we have conductance losses. In addition, we have radiation losses. In radiation losses, it is supposed that this transmission line is guiding the electromagnetic waves from point A to point B, such that the total power in point A is transferred to the point B. But effectively, between the point A and point B, the transmission line behaves slightly like an antenna. And in this case, some of the power is radiated in free space. So this radiated power represents losses. So we have, in addition to the conductor loss and dielectric loss, we have also radiation losses. We have mismatch losses. We will see that this transmission line has a characteristic impedance. And if the characteristic impedance of this transmission line does not equal the characteristic impedance of the source and does not equal the characteristic impedance of the load, so some of the power will be reflected from the source and some of the power will be reflected from the load. So not all the power coming from the source will go to the load. So this would be called mismatch losses. So in general, all these losses appears at higher frequencies more than lower frequencies. So it becomes lossy at high frequencies. Transmission lines can handle low or moderate amount of power. Effectively, the amount of power depends on the maximum current which can go inside the conductors of the transmission lines. In addition, the maximum potential difference which can be between the two conductors inside this dielectric material, between the two conductor material, because we have for each dielectric material a breakdown voltage. If the voltage is greater than, or if the electric field is greater than specific value inside the dielectric material, the dielectric material will make breakdown, and in this case could be conductor. So we have a maximum value of current according to the conductor material of the transmission line. We have a maximum potential difference between the two conductors according to the breakdown voltage of the dielectric material. So in general, transmission line can handle low or moderate amount of power, but they cannot be used for high power. By means of low or moderate amount of power, we mean that about 1 watt, 10 watt, maybe 100 watt. Okay? But if I'm talking about kilowatts, no, it will not be suitable. So in this case, we will see that waveguides would be more suitable for kilowatt and megawatt. Right? Transmission lines does not have signal distortion, effectively, theoretically. But in general, have low signal distortion. Effectively, any dielectric material has dispersion properties, and these dispersion properties will introduce signal distortion. But because the dominant mode inside the transmission line, as we will see, is transverse electromagnetic waves, which is like the wave in free space, so there will not be distortion due to the mode propagating inside the transmission line. So transmission line does not have signal distortion unless there is losses. But actually there is always losses. So effectively there is a slight signal distortion. Effectively, from the point of view of signal distortion, transmission line maybe is a good candidate for low distortion or low signal distortion. Transmission line may or may not be immune to interference. Effectively, is the problem of interference. It means that if I have two transmission lines nearby to each other, and the first transmission line has signal 1 and the second transmission line has signal 2, and at the output port of the transmission line 1, we should receive signal 1. But effectively, there is some radiation from the second transmission line to the first transmission line, and this radiation would be coupled to the signal inside the transmission line 1. So at the output port of transmission line 1, we will have signal 1 plus slight part of signal 2. This is called interference. And effectively, the concept or the problem of interference is the main problem of what we are calling electromagnetic compatibility. Effectively, transmission lines maybe have some immunity to interference, but it is not the perfect or it is not the best. According to the type of transmission lines, for example, barrel wire transmission line has very low immunity to interference. So barrel wire transmission line, it can have a great interference if we have two cable barrel wire transmission lines. On the other hand, coaxial cable transmission line, it depends on the outer conductor. Effectively, from the mechanical point of view, the outer conductor would not be a closed cylinder. So usually it is a mesh. And effectively this mesh has small slots. And from these small slots, we can assume that there is small radiation coming from this transmission line. And this radiation can couple to nearby transmission lines. So according to the density of the outer mesh of the coaxial transmission line, maybe the coaxial transmission line will have high immunity or low immunity. So with high density mesh, it will have high immunity. With low density mesh, it will have low immunity. So in general, transmission line may or may not be immune to interference. In transmission lines, there is no longitudinal electric or magnetic field components. Assuming that the direction of propagation along the transmission line is Z direction, so we don't have EZ or HZ. So the electric and the magnetic field components inside the transmission lines are purely transverse. So we say that the wave propagating inside transmission lines is transverse electromagnetic waves. And effectively, this is valid for barrel wire transmission line and for coaxial transmission line. Maybe for other types of transmission line, as we see in the following. Okay, before going to this one, this is an example of barrel wire transmission line to reduce the interference between different barrel wire transmission line. We make twisting between the transmission line parts. So we call this twisted bare transmission line. And effectively, this twisted bare or this twisting is used to reduce the interference and radiation from the discontinuity from the transmission line. Right. Other examples of transmission lines are printed transmission lines. Effectively, starting from coaxial transmission line, coaxial transmission line consists of inner conductor surrounded by an outer conductor, and the two conductors are separated by dielectric medium. So If you are going to flat such configuration, it can be represented as small strip embedded inside a dielectric slab, and this dielectric slab is surrounded by ground plane from the lower side and the upper side. And assuming that this ground slab is infinite, such that we are going to assume that we have a connection between the upper and lower conductor. So effectively, this configuration is similar to the coaxial configuration, but instead of taking the shape of cylindrical coaxial structure, now we are going to take a strip between parallel plate configuration. This configuration effectively is known as a strip line, and it was introduced as a replacement for coaxial transmission line, such that it can be designed by or can be fabricated by printed circuit approach. So in this case, we have simple fabrication process. In addition, we can add components inside the circuit by cutting the line at a certain point and adding the component and so on. After introducing the strip line, another configuration was introduced, such that the other side, including the dielectric material and the upper ground plane, was removed. And in this case, we have only the strip above a grounded dielectric slab, and this configuration is known as microstrip line. And effectively, this microstrip line is not pure transverse electromagnetic waves, but is quasi TEM wave. Means what does mean quasi? Nearly TEM wave. So we can say that it is very close to be TEM wave. And effectively, such a transmission line, such microstrip transmission line, can also operate from zero frequency. So it doesn't have a cutoff frequency. So we can start from DC to any frequency. Another configuration is coplanar strip line. In coplanar strip line, assuming that we have two parallel wire transmission line, and both of them are printed in a grounded dielectric slab, such that in terms of the DC definitions, one is positive and the other is negative. So effectively, in this case, the electric field between the two signals is between these two strips. Another configuration is coplanar waveguide. In coplanar waveguide, we have the configuration of the coaxial structure, but in printed form, such that the outer conductor would be these two metallic structures, and between them there is the inner conductor, and this inner conductor is separated by a gap, which correspond to the dielectric between the inner and the outer in the coaxial configuration. Effectively, such coplanar waveguide can be used with a ground plane or without ground plane. So there are two types of coplanar waveguides, one with ground plane and another without ground plane. Maybe the only one which is pure TEM wave here is the strip line, and almost all of the other configuration are quasi-TEM. And as I mentioned, quasi-TEM, it means that it may have a slight EZ component, very very small EZ component. So it is actually transverse magnetic, but with very small EZ component, such that we can say it is approximately or quasi-transverse electromagnetic waves. So these are different types of printed circuit lines or printed transmission lines. Here we have an example for microwave circuit. In this case, these are microstrip lines, and these microstrip lines are connected to what we are calling lumped elements. For example, these lumped elements, it may be lumped resistors or lumped capacitors, and we have a monolithic microwave integrated circuit here. And to connect this microstrip line to an external coaxial line, we need to introduce a connector, and this connector effectively is coming from coaxial configuration to microstrip line configuration. And in this case, the outer side of the coaxial structure is connected to the ground of the microstrip line, and the inner of the coaxial connector is connected to the line of or the printed line of the microstrip line. So this a simple configuration for a practical microwave circuit. And effectively this microwave amplifier. Yes, this is microwave amplifier. The other type of waveguiding structure is waveguides. Unlike transmission lines, in transmission lines we have two conductors. For example, in the case of coaxial transmission line, we have inner conductor and outer conductor. In the case of waveguide, we have only the outer conductor. So waveguides are principally a hollow pipe of conducting material. So it is like a coaxial transmission line without an inner conductor. That's what we are calling waveguides. And effectively, we are going to study waveguides in the following chapter, chapter 3. In chapter 2, we are going to study only transmission lines. Okay? Waveguides, as we see, consists of a single hollow metal pipe or conductor pipe. Because effectively, we can use, for example, plastic pipe, and this plastic pipe is coated with a conducting material. So, hollow conducting pipe. Effectively, we cannot see such waveguides at low frequencies. So, for example, if we are talking about a DC circuit, we cannot find waveguide in DC circuit. Even if we are going to talk about circuit in 1 megahertz, for example, we don't see waveguides in 1 megahertz. Why? Because effectively, waveguides can propagate electromagnetic waves. It can deliver power from point 1 to point 2 at frequency greater than what we are calling cutoff frequency of the waveguide. So, below the cutoff frequency, this waveguide cannot transfer electromagnetic energy. And effectively, this cutoff frequency depends on the wavelength of the operating signal, such that the width of the waveguide must be at least one half of the wavelength. So, if we are talking about a frequency, for example, 1 megahertz, it means that the wavelength it would be 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 8 over 10 to the power 6. So we are talking about 300 meters. 300 meters. 1 megahertz means that we are talking about 300 meters wavelength. So in this case, the waveguide should be at least has a width 150 meters. So there is no practical waveguide in this case to deliver the power at 1 megahertz. But if we are talking about 10 gigahertz, in 10 gigahertz we are talking about wavelengths 3 centimeters. So if I have a whole waveguide with a width around 1.5 centimeters would be quite sufficient to transfer electromagnetic waves at 10 GHz, right? So it can propagate a signal only at high frequency, such that the frequency is greater than the cutoff frequency, and the width must be at least 1/2 of the wavelength. And effectively, the wave inside the waveguide is not the wave propagation constant beta is not linear with omega, such that the phase velocity is not constant as a function of the frequency. So there is signal distortion inside the waveguide, even if there is no losses. In transmission line, effectively losses which introduce the signal distortion. But even without taking losses into consideration, any waveguide introduces signal distortion. So if I'm looking for the distortion, I prefer transmission lines. But if I'm looking for high power, for example, I'm looking for waveguide. From the point of interference, it has very high immunity for interference, because effectively all electromagnetic waves are bounded inside the waveguide. There is no leakage at all, or nearly there is no leakage from the waveguide. Effectively, the leakage comes from the flanges, because when we connect waveguide with another waveguide, we should connect these flanges together, and this connection would not be perfect 100%. So there would be some leakage from the flanges, but not from inside the waveguide. So effectively, waveguide is excellent in immunity for interference. And waveguides can handle large amount of power. Effectively, waveguides can handle up to megawatt. So for feeding radar systems, for feeding satellite, for feeding high power for repeater systems and so on, waveguides are excellent candidate for high power applications. Has low losses. Effectively, as I mentioned in the transmission line, we have two basic mechanisms. One is a conductor loss and one is a dielectric loss. Usually in waveguides, this whole waveguide, so the dielectric material inside the waveguide is air, and air is usually has very low losses. In addition, we have only the outer conductor in this case. So we have the conductor loss due to the outer. In the transmission line, we have conductor loss due to the outer conductor and the inner conductor. So by using only one the outer conductor, we reduce the conductor loss. And by using the air as the dielectric, we reduce the dielectric loss. So effectively, waveguide can handle large power and has low losses. Waveguide cannot propagate transverse electromagnetic waves. There must be electric field propagating in the direction, or electric field along the direction of propagation, or magnetic field along the direction of propagation. So assuming that the direction of propagation is the direction, there must be either EZ or HZ. So there should be longitudinal field component. And effectively, this longitudinal field component plays the same role of the inner conductor which we have removed. So effectively, the longitudinal component here is a replacement for the longitudinal conductor for the coaxial shape of such configuration. So in this case, the waves that can propagate inside waveguides can be transverse magnetic, means that it has magnetic component in the transverse direction only. So in this case, it has EZ component, or transverse electric. It means that it have electric field in transverse direction only. So it means that it has HZ component. So transverse electric means that we have HZ component. Waveguides can be rectangular, can be circular, sometimes can be elliptical. Sometimes it has some configuration such ridge or something like this. So effectively, we have different cross-sections for the waveguides, but the most common type is the rectangular waveguide. On the other extreme, optical fibers. Optical fibers is some sort of dielectric waveguides. An optical fiber is based on a dielectric rod, which is called the core. And usually the core has a dielectric constant, high dielectric constant. And this core is surrounded by cladding, and this cladding has slightly lower dielectric constant. So the electromagnetic waves inside the core is totally reflected inside the core. In this case, the core represents the guiding structure, and after the core and the cladding, there is a buffer layer and jacket layer just for mechanical protection. Optical fibers, as I mentioned, is based on dielectric rods. There is no conductors at all in the optical fiber. And optical fibers operate at optical or infrared frequencies. And effectively, the losses in optical fiber is very small, because if we don't have conductor loss in this case, and we usually use dielectric material, which is silicon, which is suitable for the used frequencies or the used wavelengths, such that we have minimum loss at the operating wavelengths. So have very low loss, it have minimal signal distortion, have very high bandwidth, because we are talking about the frequency of optical signal. So effectively the bandwidth is a fraction of very high carrier frequency, so it has very high bandwidth, and has very high immunity to interference, because effectively the signal is totally reflected inside the core. So there is no signal coming outside the core, there is no radiation in this case, so it has very high immunity for interference. Effectively, it is the best type of transmission line from the point of view of interference. Such that in the problem of electromagnetic compatibility, if we want to reduce the interference between some equipment, we are using optical fiber to transfer the signal from point to A to point B inside equipment 1, and another optical fiber to transfer the signal from point C to point B in the other device, such that we are sure that such optical fiber will not interface to each other, and then we will convert the signal from optical signal to microwave signal once again. So optical fiber play a very important role in electromagnetic compatibility to reduce the interference. But the main problem is that they are not suitable for high power at all. If we are talking in terms of 10 watts or 100 watts for coaxial transmission line, and if we are talking about kilowatts and megawatts for waveguides, in optical fibers we are talking about milliwatts. So they are not suitable at all for high power. The wave propagating inside the optical fiber has both longitudinal electric and magnetic field components simultaneously. So in this case, we don't even have transverse electric or transverse magnetic, we are talking about hybrid modes, such that it is a combination between transverse electric and transverse magnetic. Optical fiber are classified into two main types, single mode optical fiber and multi-mode optical fiber. In single mode optical fiber, carrier signal mode, as with the mode and transmission line waveguide, requires fiber diameter very small relative to wavelengths. And effectively, the main advantage of single mode optical fiber is that it has a very small distortion, very small signal distortion. But its bandwidth is very small too. On the other hand, multi-mode optical fiber, as fiber diameter has large rate of wavelengths, it operates in the principle of total internal friction or critical angle effect, and effectively it is suitable for wide bandwidths but has larger signal distortion compared with single mode optical fiber. So depending on the bandwidth of the signal and the degree of distortion which can be accepted, we can determine if we are going to single mode or multi-mode. And also, if we are going to use multi-mode optical fiber, because of the large distortion, we can make repeaters at smaller distance such that we reshape the signal once again to its original to avoid a large distortion. Should be noted that in optical fiber, the carrier is optical frequency, but the modulating signal or the baseband signal is often microwave signal. So effectively, we have optical carrier and microwave modulating signal in optical fiber. This is briefly the different types of transmission lines. In this chapter, we are going to study the basic transmission line, which is composed of barrel wire transmission line or coaxial transmission line. We'll see how to define the signal flow through microwave or through such transmission lines, and what will be the difference between the behavior of such transmission line in microwave and in low frequency. This is our plan in this chapter, and see you starting from the next video in the analysis of transmission lines. Okay.